Adesso chiamo Vimeus. Anche di Vimeus troverete una sintesi nella cartella che avete.
Good morning, everybody. I'm really happy to be here to honor the work of Augusto Palmanari in the field of adolescent development. So I will talk about adolescence today. When I thought about the person that Augusto was and I thought about his work, I think that you can discover two stories in him, in his person, in his personality and in his work. And the two stories are, the first time he, first place, he, Augusto really believed in young people. He believed in positive development of young people. And you can see that in many places in his chapter in the Lerner book on the development, on the developmental science of adolescence. So he believed in young people. On the other hand, and that's the second part of this story, he also knew that adolescents could go to strong experiences of crisis. So he knew the positive and the negative side of adolescence. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. So two stories about adolescent development that were inspired by the way Augusto thought about adolescence. But let me take you first to a picture from 2008. You can see here Augusto. You can see Alessandra Fermani from Macerata University. You can see on the left-hand side Elisabetta Cocchetti. Hi, Elisabetta. Good to see you. And myself. And what were we doing there in 2008 at Macerata? We were there at the occasion of the doctoral defense of Elisabetta on identity development. And what happened there? There, in a way, we celebrated that there was a new idea about the development of identity, that we have found a cross-cultural equivalent model of identity formation, and that we had made a model that really could say something about development, so not on differential, on differences between adolescence and in identity, but really on the developmental process. And guess what? Who was the person who was at the base of this process. That was Augusto. Because he brought us together. And this is another example that he really, Augusto was a person that was a, he had really a good sense of talent in young people. And that, again, was an, is an example of that he believed in young people. So he discovered the talent of Elisabetta, and he sent her to me. So he connected a young researcher and a senior researcher. And that was really some of his really big capacities, to connect people that could work together. And nowadays we have many indices of scientific merit. And you probably all know of them. But we do not have an index of this connection merit, so to say, or this connectivity merit. But if we had one, Augusto would be really in the top of that kind of index. So thank you, Augusto, for bringing many, many people together. So I said that Augusto had a positive view on adolescence. And they also said that he knew what adolescent experience was. And when you look in his his chapter on the learner book that you got all today, you can see that one of his first studies was on adolescents moving from one residential arrangement to another one. And then that really made them feel a bit expelled from and moved into a new situation and gave them a lot of notions that they really did not know where they were and where they were to go. So that gave them a sort of an experience of crisis. So that was the adolescent crisis. It's in a book or a publication where my colleague here was the first author on, from 1975, if I got it quite well. So we had this crisis experience. So that brings me to my presentation of today. It's just an ordinary research presentation. So we have two stories on adolescent development. The negative story, which is adolescent storm and stress. So it's on negativity in adolescence. And the positive story, adolescence as the formative period in life. The period in where people are formed to organized individuals. And I will use longitudinal data on a couple of issues. So, is adolescence a difficult period in life? What you see here is, we asked in a national survey in the Netherlands, we asked from about 2,500 fathers and mothers, we asked about, what do you think is the most difficult period in upbringing of your children? So, and we gave them options, they could indicate, where is this, yeah. They could indicate the baby period, the toddler period, the child, the school age period, and the two periods of adolescence. And what you clearly see is that these parents believed that adolescence is the most difficult period in upbringing of children. So this indeed adds to this notion of storm and stress. So let's see, is there adolescent storm and stress? Is there negativity in adolescence? Here we have, so this is all longitudinal data. So this is the same individuals followed across time. So in this slide, you see individuals, a sample of about 1,300 kids, followed from 12 till 20. So, and what you see here, and here we see parent-adolescent conflict. So, which is negativity between parents and adolescents, quarrels and disagreements. And what you clearly see is that it increases from early to middle adolescence, so from ages 12 to 16. And after that, it decreases. So indeed, there is something like conflict. Here we have something that was really close to Tashville's notion on in-group, out-group differentiation. Here we have youth-centrism. And youth-centrism is something that we, as young people, oppose them, the adults. So we are two distinct categories, and actually, we young people are superior to them because they're stupid old people. So that's what we call youth-centrism. It's this attitude scale, of course, and here you see one example of an item, a young people and adults, two totally distinct worlds. And when you look at this issue of youth-centrism, you see again that it increases from early to middle adolescence peaks here and decreases thereafter. So indeed, again, something like storm and stress. Here we have direct aggression, again, from 12 till 20. Direct aggression is just simple verbal and physical aggression of adolescents to their peers. And we see it peaks in early adolescence, it decreases somewhat from early to middle adolescence, and then it decreases totally. So again, something like storm and stress. Here we have the well-known age crime curve. So how delinquent are young people? And what we clearly see, and this is really an established finding across many countries, we see that delinquency peaks in middle adolescence. So it increases from early to middle adolescence, decreases thereafter. And here, finally, we have generalized anxiety. Generalized anxiety is at the heart of anxiety. So it's worry about yourself, your environment, and the future. And you see that it decreases from early to middle adolescence, but increases thereafter. So again, storm and stress. So you could say, when you take these five things together, indeed, there's turmoil everywhere in adolescence. There's conflict in middle adolescence, there's youth centrism in middle adolescence, there's direct aggression in early middle adolescence, there's delinquency in middle adolescence, and there's generalized anxiety more in the later part of adolescence. So indeed, we can worry about adolescence. It's a difficult period. It's a period where there's lots of turmoil. So indeed, maybe we could say there's some negativity in adolescence. And we can understand why it's difficult for parents. So that is maybe some sort of comfort for you. Okay, another story. As I said, Augusto, he really believed in young people. And he had a high sensitivity to find out talent in young people. So, and that's the part that comes closer to the second part of my presentation of today, adolescence as a formative period in life. And Erik Erikson coined adolescence as a period of identity formation, the period in which individuals find out who they are. Is this true? Let's take a look at a couple of images. So here we have personality. You probably know that personality can be described in terms of five personality traits. And here we have the development of two of them, agreeableness, so being nice and open to other people, and openness, so being open to new experiences. Here again, we had from 12 to 20, and you see that indeed, when adolescents get older, they become more agreeable. You also see, when they get older, they become more open to new experiences. So that's a positive development. Here we have the most complex slide of today, at least for my part. Here we have the organization of personality within the individual, and that's an index that we call profile stability. So just look at the left-hand side of this slide. We go at a certain point of time, we call that T1. We go to a person. This is a slide of one single person, a picture of one single person. And we ask him to describe himself or herself in terms of extroversion, agreeableness, conscientiousness, emotional stability, and openness. And then we look at which trait is ranked highest, and then the second highest, and then going up from high to low. So we have a ranking of the big five traits within that individual. And then 1 year later, we go to the same individual. And we again ask about these big five traits, and again we obtain a ranking. And what you can see here is that at T2, the ranking is quite different of the personality traits than at T1. What does that mean? That does mean that this person, this individual, does not have a very organized self-view. Because at the second point in time, he gives a totally different description of his personality that's really different from time one. Okay. And here we have another example. And here we did the same, another individual. And here we see the ranking of the traits at T1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And here we see the ranking of the traits at this, 1 year later. And we see that's virtually identical. The only thing that differs is that trait 3 became rank 4 at T1, and trait 4 became trait 3 at T2. So this is an individual with a really highly organized personality description. This is a person who knows who he is or she is. So the difference between the left-hand side, the profile stability of 0.33, and the right-hand side, the profile stability of 0.76, is the difference between an organized personality and a disorganized personality and a organized personality. And here we see how it develops. Here again, you see from 12 till 20, you see it developed, and you see that there's a regular increase of profile stability across adolescence. So what happens in adolescence is that people get an organized self-view, or an organized view of their own personality. So we have growth over time. You see that there's a difference between boys and girls, but at the end it has disappeared. That's something that we often see in adolescence, that there are initially gender differences, but they disappear. So gender differences, also in this case, tend to disappear. Let's move to another thing. What's often said of adolescents is that they, one time you meet them, they're very happy, and the other day you meet them, they are really, really unhappy. So they have what we call mood swings. So they move in mood from one day to another day. And here, so this is also that we studied. So what we did here, so we went to those kids 5 days in a week. So day one to day five. And we asked about their emotions. So for instance, in this case, we asked about their happiness. And here, the lighter line, you see, this is a kid that was unhappy one day, happy the other day, unhappy the third day, happy the fourth day, and unhappy again the fifth day. So that was an individual with high, what we call high mood swings or high mood variability. And here, the blue line, you see an individual that has a quite stable happiness, quite stable level of happiness. So, and then what we did in this study, we tapped into this mood variability across 5 years, across 75 days, so we had a 75 developmental trend curve for this mood development. And here is what you see. So from 13 to 17, you see the lines for boys and girls. What you see is that mood variability decreases when kids get older. So they get more stable mood. Which, if you just step back for one moment and you think about the profile stability of personality, which is quite consistent with this notion of profile stability. On the one hand, their mood becomes more stable, so they have less mood swings. On the other hand, that the description of their personality becomes more consistent over time. So these things really fit quite well together. Then let's move to parent-adolescent relationships and problems. What you see here a kid that feels lots of support from his parents, does have low levels of conflict with the parents, and experiences low power differences with parents. So this is what we call a harmonious relationship. And here we see how it develops between ages 12 and 20. And what you see is, from early to middle adolescence, you see it's quite stable. So we have around 35% of kids that have positive relationship with parents. And after that, it increases. So in the second half of adolescence, the relationship with parents become more positive. So parent-adolescent harmony grows. Here you have another example. Here we have kids that have no problems. So they have low levels of direct aggression. They have low levels of anxiety, generalized anxiety disorder. So they have absence of problems. We see that the kids that have absence of problems, the number increases to adolescence, so from about 50% to about 65%. Again, positive development. So we could say this is something like that we would call positive development and a formative period. So here we have the five developmental things together. We have increase of personality traits. We have increase of profile stability of personality. We have decrease of mood variability. We have increase of parent-adolescent harmony. And we have increase of kids that do not experience problems. So, indeed, formation everywhere. So is adolescence a period of storm and stress, so the negative view, or is it the formative period? Well, basically it's both. Both stories are true. But, and here I go with the positive view that Augusto had on adolescence, on young people, there is positive outcome for the majority of young people. But, and that's the crisis thing, when you simply look at the prevalence of problems when kids are 20, what do we see? We still see high mood variability in 10% of the young people, so unstable mood. We see in 12% of the young people that they have a turbulent relationship with parents. We see in 21% of kids that they are anxious. And we see in 30%, this is what Terry Moffat called the life persistent offenders, we see that the 13% are still delinquent. So, what's the end? What is then the end verdict of what I wanted to say? First thing is, believe in adolescence. So go with Augusto. Believe in adolescence. Believe in the positivity of their development, because the majority of them will turn out fine. But on the other hand, be aware of stay on the alert for this 10 till 15 or 20% that are really in danger and that are vulnerable for positive development. So believe in adolescence, so go with Augusto. Believe in adolescence, but stay alert for them who will experience a lot of crisis. Thank you.
Grazie, Elin.